I don't know how to start this video. I think I just have to start with the fact that speed is forever ruined for me. Fast cars are now ruined. I can't see cars as fast anymore because of this thing. So welcome to the autofocus video on the Rimac's Nevera. This is a sort of a companion video to the video that's on the main channel that I'm hopefully going to put up at the same time, which is just my first reaction and experience with the fastest production car ever on planet Earth, a $2.5 million quad motor, 2,000 horsepower electric hypercar. It's absurd. And I went through a lot in that main video, but also just like now that we've had it here for a bit and used it and driven it for a little while, there's a lot of little things that I haven't been able to put in that main video that I still wanna show you. So that's what this is. This is perfect for the autofocus channel. There's a bunch of other videos we've had like this. This is not my car, of course, by the way. I'm here in Ohio with the Triple F collection. They were kind enough to let me use it, let me drive the thing. And they've encouraged me to drive a bunch of other stuff, and maybe we'll do some of that here too. But let me show you about around the Nevera, just because there's a lot of cool stuff here. And then I'll sort of explain what it's like to drive it, but it's just absurd. It's absurd. But I'm gonna walk you around, first of all, what is this car? So like I said, it's an electric two-door hypercar from a Croatian company called Rimac. We actually did a video on the Rimac Concept 1. That was a few years ago. That's the first car this company ever made. And this now here is the second car they've ever made. It was the Concept 2 when they first introduced it, but now it's the Rimac Nevera. It's an electric car, quad motors, 120 kilowatt hours, 2,000-ish horsepower, and a whole lot of speed records is what's been happening with this car. I believe the number is 23 records that it set in one day, the last of which was the record for the most records set in one day by a car. 0 to 60, 1.7 seconds. 0 to 100, 3.2 seconds. 0 to 200, I'll put a bunch of the numbers up on the screen just so you can get an idea, but the numbers don't even really make sense. But let me show you what this spec of the car looks like. It's the sixth chassis ever out of 150, and I believe it's the second one ever in North America. So first of all, just having a look around here, it's got this blue-green paint color. It's kind of hard to appreciate from just a single camera angle, but it changes from blue to green depending on, oh, you can kind of see that, depending on the camera angle, especially in the sun, it looks a lot more green. And then there's a lot of carbon fiber all around this car. Here's the logo, carbon fiber in there. Big hood scoop. There is no front trunk. There you can see, fan, radiator. And there's a whole bunch of carbon fiber here, aero here, lots of aero bits. It's on regular Pilot Sport 4S's, which is crazy. Huge carbon ceramic brakes. Nevera there, carbon fiber here with a little bit of a light. We'll get to the inside in a second, but even the window trim is carbon fiber. This is the charge port. Can't access that without opening the door, so I'll get to that too. But more carbon fiber. I'll get to those lights in a second. Carbon fiber even down here, that's a lot. And then you get to the back and there is this huge wing, which is active, it moves around. And there's also some active aero down there, and this whole diffuser, the splitter in the back, is all carbon fiber. And you might have seen some footage of this car, but look at the lights here. You can just reach right in there. The light is this LED strip here, and there's active aero, air being channeled out through here as it comes over the side of the car and leaves. That's a lot. Now, the first thing you would do if you owned this car would be to grab the key. This is the Nevera's key. There's actually a bunch of different buttons on it. There's a lock button, which locks everything up, but there's an unlock button up here, which unlocks the car. But there are also, if I can zoom in, a state of charge and charge port button, a trunk button, and a blank button. Okay, let's start with the trunk button. Hold that down. The back of this little piece of glass here pops open, and you have a trunk in the Rimac. Trunk. There is about enough space in here for maybe a duffel bag and a half, maybe a duffel bag and a backpack. You might be wondering actually what's behind this little thing right here, so you can pop it open. And it's a tire inflator kit and a first aid kit. And fun fact, a perfect spot to put your lav mic when you're laving up this car. Not that it makes a ton of noise, but that is removable, and that's pretty cool that you actually have a little bit of storage behind your head. And it doesn't ruin visibility because it's already ruined by the wing. So you're good there. Look, this thing is lined with carbon fiber. Honestly, the number one thing I've noticed around this car that's really hard to explain in person is how well built, how quality this thing actually is. Basically every part of it is either carbon fiber or metal. Now these lights over here on the side are really interesting. They don't actually legally get to stay on while you're driving, but they do have a couple of Easter eggs while the car is stationary as it is. You might have remembered the SOC button, state of charge. If I hit that once, the lights will show me roughly the state of charge of the car. And it only does it briefly. So you just saw there is basically 2/3 full. So I'll hit it again, show me. And it's kind of flickering on camera, but those two mostly lit up for being 2/3 full. And then the other one, which is really funny, is in the car settings, which I'll show you the software in a bit, you get to choose which flag it shows. Croatian flag, US flag, or Britain flag. So hit this button, blank one here, and you'll briefly see a flag. Blink and you'll miss it. Ready? I have the US one here, red, white, and blue. Those two turn white, that was the flag, and it's gone. That's it. I think the more I walk around this car and the more I look at it, but also the more I feel it and actually interact with it, the more I feel the Bugatti influence. Volkswagen Group bought Rimac between the first and second cars that they made and sort of merged the brand with Bugatti. So it's Bugatti Rimac. And I mean, it feels like a Bugatti. Here's how I open the door. So it's unlocked. You sort of feel underneath here for the latch, pop the latch open. And there are the doors, and there is a, it's actually kind of a heavy door. There is a little bit of effort required to open it, but once you do, you see a ton more carbon fiber. All of this dry carbon fiber, the actual body of the car, the sill here, carbon fiber inlays here, it's the blue interior. And I'm gonna step inside in a minute, but you basically see carbon everywhere. Now, this is one of the things that's never easy about getting into a $2 million super low car without scuffing anything. It's super low, and I think I'm about the maximum height a human can be to fit in this car and not get claustrophobic. So I'm gonna close this door. You can see right now, this piece looks like it's at my eye level, right? Or head level, but there's a cutout in the top of the door. And it actually is just a little bit of a scoop over my head. So it actually stays over my head. So I'm fine. 6'3". 6'4" might be the limit. So, okay, once you're actually in this car, there are so many Easter eggs that it's actually a little bit overwhelming. I think I'm gonna have to just go from left to right in order to try not to miss any of them. All right, from left to right. First of all, ton of dry carbon fiber over here. It's decently spacious. I'm gonna try not to get distracted though. Okay, number one, this is the door handle. It says Rimac on it. And when you pull it, that's how you open this door here. And you do really have to push out with your elbow to actually get that door open. But I want you to listen to the thud it makes when you close it. I don't know if that's gonna translate on camera, but that sounded amazing. Okay, this is metal, really, really high quality, right? Speakers are all over the car. These sound pretty good. This is your start stop. So with the foot on the brake, I hit stop, and this stops, I hit start, and it's ready to go into gear. And that's how I switch from park to reverse to neutral to drive. My God, it's in drive. Okay, back to park. But then you get over to the steering wheel here in the middle, and it's got this nice screen behind the dash. The screen is pretty great here. And there's the steering wheel. It's got a nice little bit of dry carbon fiber in here. The horn sounds normal, but you do have these metal buttons over to the sides, which are gonna control your UI. Now, there is a voice control button here. I've tried hitting it. When I hit it, nothing happens. It actually just tells me that this car is going to get voice controls and Android Auto and Apple CarPlay with a software update. I wanna believe that. That sounds pretty cool. But there's a bunch of other buttons here, the headlights, the blinkers are on the steering wheel as well. So there's no stalks, no stalks, just drive selection and blinkers, no stalks needed. And that's the controls of this car. There is a 360 camera in the Rimac Nevera, and it's pretty good. When I turn the steering wheel, it adjusts the lines. Like everything here is live and in real time. And when I open the door, it's funny, it just shows a big blank spot because it knows it can't see out of that camera anymore. But when I close that, completes the view. There is a little spot for the key in here, which is where I've put it. But spoiler, when you drive this car with any sort of fun, this key shoots out into your lap. It just does. It doesn't stay in place, but that's the best they can do. There's not a whole lot of storage in here. No door storage in this car. Hardly any center console storage. The seats are barely adjustable, but here's our look at the seats. Really nice. Not even some crazy carbon fiber buckets, just like normal seats. This is a bit of a Bugatti feel. It says Rimac here. Of course, chassis number 6 out of 150, designed and engineered and manufactured in Croatia. And now we start to get to the fun parts. So there's two more dials in the middle here. And there's actually a front dial and a back dial. The back dial is for traction control settings, and the front dial is for modes. So cruise mode, sport mode, track mode, and mother freaking drift mode. I'm not gonna do that now, but you can see everything turn orange and light up, and you can dial in your degree of slip. This is one of the most unbelievable cars ever to drift, but we're not gonna do that here in this video. Back to track mode, which still has traction control off, but now we're red. And then you go to sport mode and down to cruise mode. And even lower is range mode. Then over here, you actually get to dial in how much power you have on the front axle and the rear axle. I've also never seen this in a car before, but let's say you want to go to sport mode. That's by default 70% front and rear power. But like I said, it's a quad motor car, so how about 85% at the front and 95% at the rear? Or 100% at the front, or 100% at the rear. You can do a full rear wheel drive setup, front wheel drive setup. All of this is dialable in, especially on the track. That's gonna be really fun. So that's just a taste of what this stuff is capable of, but it's all rock solid. This is metal buttons in here, and all of these switches in here are all made of metal. This is the window switch. Window does not go all the way down, unfortunately, but that pulls the window up. You've got your lights, you've got your controls, and this is a touchscreen. It also has this sort of a touchpad here. I don't think it's very good. It's let me swipe over maybe once, never twice in a row. I've never gotten it to work twice in a row. It's not super responsive, but the touchscreen part itself is actually pretty decent. So, first of all, Easter egg, boom. This thing moves back, and there is some storage back here. It's good for a phone, it's not a ton of storage. And then the other little bit of storage behind you, cup holders. I don't know if you knew about that in the Rimac, but there's tiny cup holders back there. But let's look at the software. So this car, like I said, they're claiming they're gonna actually do a software update to give it Android Auto and Apple CarPlay. If it actually does that, it will be one of the most well-specced, well-equipped supercars like this I've ever seen. But as of right now, they just kind of have this simple UI. And it's basically just sort of a panel layout. So right now on the left, the leftmost panel, we just sort of have like live power and torque numbers and a map. Then on this next panel, a map, also in whatever your phone is connected to. And then over here, you actually have all the other stuff that's mostly used for controlling the car. It's decently responsive. I'm not mad. It seems like the more expensive cars get, the worse the in-car entertainment gets. So I'm decently happy with this. Now playing media, the 360 camera view, you can just pop into at any time. Navigation, just to see where you are on the map. But most importantly, connecting to your phone, state of charge, state of charge, and then all of your car settings, of which there are a few, not too much crazy stuff in here. Like you can connect a mobile app and get some mobile updates and update the car software, decide what the exterior lights do. So there's your flag selection, USA, Croatia, or Britain, which is fun. Connected to Wi-Fi, etc. But it's funny, state of charge here, we're showing 71% state of charge, which seems pretty good for a car with 300 miles of range. That sounds great. But I also think it knows how hard it gets driven, because it's showing 73 miles of range with 71% battery. That's not very much. And that's even in range mode too. So basically, if you drive the car hard, it adapts, and this car has not been babied, so it's being honest about how many miles you're gonna get. So it's really, I think it's actually gonna be able to show me how many, well, basically I've been getting like, oh yeah, there's your average consumption. 662 watt hours per mile over our last 2 miles. Nothing too crazy. Okay. I also wanna show you these switches right here. So you do have a front nose lift, which is great.
You have the setup button. If I were to actually give some feedback to this car, these menus only show up for a short amount of time and then just go away. Not really sure why. Like, let them stay up. They're menus, right? I have a switch. I can make them go away if I want to. So anyway, this setup button shows us the setup of how the car drives, which is throttle response, suspension, steering assistance, and the spoiler position. And that's all in your setup based on your mode. So if I go to cruise mode, I got a little more steering assistance. If I go to sport mode, you can see things get a little more direct and aggressive. Track mode, things are as direct and aggressive as they get. So I'm gonna dial that back down just for safety. But then you go to control, and that's your car controls. So we were looking around this car for a while, like, how do you adjust the mirrors? How do you adjust the seats? There's no controls on here. Turns out it's all here on the screen, kind of like a Tesla, I guess. You tap which seat you want to adjust and then move the seat position based on this touchscreen stuff here. So you can change the seat height up or down. There's a pretty good amount of adjustment here. And change the backrest position to lean forward or backwards. That's all on the touchscreen. So the mirrors also move the same way, moving around just like that. Power adjusting, good to see. But then also move your steering wheel just like that. So all the lights, all the controls are at your controls here. Good to know. That's mostly it for Easter eggs. This is actually a volume knob just for your media volume. And listen to this glove box. It's one of the weirdest sounding glove boxes I've ever heard. Kind of makes a weird unlatching noise. And then, oh, by the way, there's a huge screen on the other side. Maybe not huge, but that shows you as a passenger the real-time speed and power output of the car. Oh, by the way, real air conditioning vents. You don't have to do crazy insane air conditioning vents. All of the HVAC controls here, you can choose to open or close on the touchscreen, but then you actually point them with the vents in here, and they all have the little Rimac logo inside. That's pretty clever.
I think that's about it. I mean, there's a lot of logos everywhere. Oh, and there's storage in here. Two USB-C ports and two spots for phones, and it does fit a Pixel Fold. Oh my God, this car is so cramped. I have to... First time a Pixel Fold has ever been in a Rimac. It's pretty cool. But I want to show you the outside, so let's bump open this this heavy door here. The whole thing opens up, hit stop, and show you the outside. So the fun about testing a car like this that is completely unattainable and never going to be purchased by someone like myself is just like trying to find other things to compare it to. It doesn't really compare to any other fast cars. Oh, one more thing I wanted to show you. Halfway open, there's a little slot right here. Opens the charge port door. And yeah, it does CCS charging, so that's your combined charging system. You can do 0 to 80% in like 20 minutes and just pop that down right there. And there's a camera there, some other cameras in the car. There is a acclaimed feature that I don't think really will ever exist, which is like an AI driving coach. We'll see if that ever happens. Anyway, I was talking about comparing it to other cars. It doesn't, in terms of speed or performance, really have a comp right now. Literally in the world. Like, you see that car over there? 1,000 horsepower Bugatti Veyron Vitesse Roadster. This one smokes that car. It smokes the Chiron, it smokes the Plaid, it smokes basically everything else that exists. So it's really hard for me to explain how fast it is. I'd say go watch the main channel autofocus video for more of that. But I'm kind of using the Tesla Roadster as a comparison, because if you remember when Elon first unveiled in 2017 the new Tesla Roadster 2.0, it was supposed to be the hardcore smackdown to gasoline vehicles. And then Tesla had a bunch of other priorities come up, and now they've got the Cybertruck thing they're trying to do and mass producing some other stuff. So that's sort of on the back burner. And we thought, well, that's too bad. That hardcore smackdown is going to have to wait. But then this car came out, and it's not nearly as attainable. This is a $2 million car versus a $200,000 Roadster. But this is the actual king of performance now as far as actual production cars go. They're only making 150 of these. If you ever see one on the road, just know you're witnessing something really special. But yeah, I would highly recommend going and checking out the autofocus video on the main MKBHD channel where we have a lot of fun with this thing. Either way, I think that's it. My life has changed forever and fast cars are ruined for me. Thanks for watching. Catch you in the next one. Peace.
Okay. Ha ha ha.